This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. Whether you're a beginner or a seasoned professional, No Wave Academy is your ultimate educational resource to help bring your artistry to the next level. Our renowned roster of instructors include Nick Runge, Mia Bergeron, Sean Cheatham, Kate Zambrano, David Chaffetz, Paul Christina, John Wentz, and many more. Some of these artists have appeared on this very podcast, while others have been featured in exhibitions at the No Wave Gallery and museums around the world. Here at No Wave Academy, we believe that everyone has a unique artistic expression. With guidance, experience, and the proper tools, students have the ability to invigorate and elevate their work. Unlock and unblock your inner creative voice. Join us and walk into the next chapter of your personal artistic evolution. Go to nowaveacademy.com. Type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. That's NOHWaveAcademy.com. Now, onto the episode. Hi, everyone. This is your host, Yoshino, and you're listening to episode 204 of Artist Decoded. And today I'm really excited to be releasing this episode with my friend, photographer Jingna Zhang. And we originally had her on the podcast 200 episodes ago for episode number 4. Keep in mind that this was completely coincidental. I didn't plan for this to happen or anything at all, but I was really glad to be able to do this podcast episode with her to catch up. And let me just read you a bit of Jingna's bio. Born in Beijing and raised in Singapore, Jingna Zhang is a fashion and fine art photographer and director based in New York City and Seattle. Imbued with love for the Pre-Raphaelites and Japanese anime, Jingna's work interweaves Asian aesthetics with Western art styles, bringing unique visions of painterly and fantastical images to fashion and fine art photography. Before photography, Jingna was a world-class air rifle shooter representing Singapore at the Commonwealth Games and World Cup. She was the only female founder of a North American esports team in StarCraft II and was once a concept artist and illustrator's agent with clients including LucasArts, Amazon Publishing, and Sony Online Entertainment. Jingna majored in fashion design before dropping out of school to pursue photography. She is an alumna of Stanford's Innovation and Entrepreneurship Program Ignite and Forbes Asia 30 Under 30 Listmaker. Jingna's work has appeared on multiple editions of Vogue, Elle, and Harper's Bazaar. Her clients include Mercedes Benz, Montblanc, and Lancome. Jingna's fine artworks have exhibited at Leica Gallery Milan, Tsinghua University, and Japan Creative Center in Singapore. She has spoken at Laguna College of Art and Design, Monterrey Institute of Technology, and Square Enix. So let's jump right in. But before we begin, please go to our YouTube page for some additional content, including some full episodes. And if you can, please go to our iTunes page and leave us a review. All right, so here it is, my conversation with Jingna Zhang. Hope you enjoy it. Yeah, this is definitely a much better setup than we did that first conversation. And you know what's interesting is that first conversation, I think you were episode number 4. Uh-huh. And now I'm going to release your episode and it's going to be episode 204.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's insane. How many years has it been? I don't even know.
How many years since that podcast? Well, I started doing interviews in 2015 and I think I released yours in, it was either September or October 2015.
Okay, dude. Now I feel old.
It's okay. I'm older than you. So for a couple of years, I'm older than you for a couple of years, but it's, you know, it is what it is. We're getting older, you know, what can you do? Right.
It's life. Yeah.
Yeah. But, anyways, yeah, thanks for, you know, taking this time, and, you know, it's good. It was good the other day just to catch up with you and, you know, just talk about life. And, you know, we were talking a bit about animes, and I mean, even right now we were talking about animes, but, like I was saying, I'm not as well versed as you are in terms of the understanding of the whole metaverse of animes, if you will. So you might have to educate me a bit on it. But you were saying that, you know, prior to us starting to record, you were saying that there's some judgments that you would get from clients and agents about being into things that were outside of the spectrum of photography. And can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. So, I was just mentioning how there's a little bit of there's a certain expectation about how you're supposed to be as a fashion photographer or somebody who is in the fashion industry, right? And I am pretty open about my hobbies, my interests. So I tweet about, like, when I was into StarCraft 2 and I had my team, I tweeted about StarCraft a lot. And when I like anime, I tweet about anime, you know, when I love something about it. But I would have agents in the past who would call me up, especially at periods when I'm having like a really hard time with life and I feel maybe anime or video games is what is getting me through. And they would call me up and say like, oh, we have clients who are wondering if you're even, like, you know, doing photography properly, or they're concerned. And I mean, on the one hand, like, it's a little bit controlling of what I can say. Like, you picked me up as an artist because you loved my honesty in how I communicated with my audience. But once it doesn't serve the fashion narrative, suddenly it's not so interesting, you know? And also, as an agent, it's their job to protect the artist, I feel like. And they should be reassuring, you know, their clients, like, Jingna is... She's doing her job, you know, or she's just really passionate and she likes to tweet about, well, I mean, whatever you have to say, right, to make a client happy and be professional. Because if I show up on set, I am going to be professional because it is my job and I'm good at what I do. So there's a little bit of that. And I get really happy when I meet creatives and artists that, like, love anime and manga, you know, and we collaborate together. It feels like, oh, we can really communicate with each other, or there's certain things that we just understand. But there will also be friends, you know, even in different scenes I worked in, they would just be like, wait, you guys got an Xbox and the only thing you're playing is like the only JRPG that Game Pass has on it. And you feel like you're judged a little bit for, you know, being an otaku or being a weeb and all these things. And it's like,
what does an otaku mean exactly?
I think in Japan it's not perceived so well. It just means someone who is super passionate about a single topic to the point of being a little bit extreme, and they're probably socially awkward. So you can say, like, I am an anime otaku, or I am a Gundam otaku because I like Gundam a lot. Or someone, you can say they're a camera otaku. Like, they just really love everything about it, and they study, like, a lot into it. But overseas, I think it's probably depends on who you ask. It's more of an accepted term. In general, just like, oh, I'm an anime fan, you know.
I see. Yeah. So would you be getting these sort of criticisms from agents that are based in the US or more so overseas?
This was in North America. Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's interesting too, because just from my understanding of, I mean, we were even talking about this on the phone of fashion as just a concept in itself, you know, I don't have like the dictionary on me, but I mean, I could probably look it up on Google, but, you know, speaking of something that's of fashion, it's of the moment, right?
Yeah.
And I think psychologically, there's a lot of things. I mean, if you're taking part in that industry and, you know, that is your main source of income, I think unless you can be really self-reflective and think outside of yourself, then you might embed certain ideologies that are of fashion or of the moment. And if it doesn't necessarily serve fashion, like for an agent that might have that point of view, then maybe they think that you might be, spending your time in a place where they wouldn't want to spend their time, for instance, mm-hmm. right?
Fair enough. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's true.
But I mean, it's, yeah, I don't know. It's interesting just to think of, commercialization and fashion in these various worlds that if you don't step outside of the world and do other things, then you might not challenge that narrative rather. Right. But I think with you, mm-hmm. it's interesting yeah. because you've stepped into many worlds, and just from an outsider's mm-hmm. point of view, you've been able to combine all of these worlds into your own sort of vision of things, you know? So, I mean, mm-hmm. you were even an artist rep for an artist before, right?
Yeah.
Is that correct? Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's right.
And then you were also on the National Air Rifle team.
Yeah.
And it just seems that, I mean, I've known you for a while now, mm-hmm. and it just seems that you are constantly following your interest, you know, and whether that can be translated to other people, then that's not really on you, is it? It's, mm-hmm. you know, you're just living your life, right?
So that's pretty much it. Uh-huh. I think being an artist is just about self-expression, right? And honesty. And I think a lot of us are attracted to art creation because it's a way we can express ourselves, you know, and if it has to become stifling, then that's kind of working against the purpose of why, at least personally for me, why I pursued art in the first place. Yeah. Mm. So that's something I take very, like, it's difficult for me to take.
Mm. Why did you pursue art in the first place?
I think it just seemed like freedom, like something I have personal control over. So when I went into fashion, I studied fashion in school. It wasn't because I was passionate about fashion. You know, I wasn't a girl who was like following fashion trends, or I never did makeup. You know, I had no idea about those kind of stuff. But I was really into Japanese rock and like the genre of like visual K, where how people had like crazy makeup, hair, costumes. And
yeah,
like I thought ex-Japan. Yeah. And I thought it would be interesting if I could make costumes, you know? So I was in the Air Rifle team, and as with many competitive sports, there's a lot of team politics, you know? There were so much things that were extremely unfair, and the story is so convoluted, but I'll give one example. Like, my mother was my coach. She was a national team coach, and one thing led to another. There was so much drama that they tried to take me away from having her as my coach. So I was assigned to somebody else for my coach for a major games that was coming up, Commonwealth Games. And to further like enforce, or should we say, I don't know what the purpose is, but anyway, I was banned from speaking to her because they were worried that I would receive coaching. So I was banned from speaking to my own mother at a shooting range. So there was so much like extreme sense of control that is so abnormal, that when I sort of discovered photography through school, and I was doing photo shoots, I could dictate the art direction, I could dictate the shots, I could dictate the hair and makeup. And if somebody made me uncomfortable, I could say goodbye and leave the team, and there are no real consequences in the same way that with a Olympic sport does, you know. For example, mm-hmm. I was representing Singapore for 5 or 6 years, and I was participating in like the ISSF, like International Shooting Federation championships, like World Cups and stuff. So once you have your name in those like world level tournaments, ISSF sanctioned games, you cannot change a country and represent like a new country. For like, if I'm so desperate to do air rifle shooting, and I loved it so much, and a different country was willing to take me and give me a citizenship, right? I have to basically take a break for 2 years from competitive shooting. And as a competitor, you can't not compete for 2 years and still keep like the same level of like you know, peak mental performance. It's just very difficult.
Totally.
So
makes sense.
So there was nowhere for me to run, right? I couldn't leave my national team. I couldn't go to a different team. Like, it's not like in bigger countries where you have different sponsored private teams by, you know, like some corporate sponsors, that like there was nowhere for me to go. So when I discovered photography and art in general, it just felt like it really symbolized freedom for me, like a place. Wow. I just have so much control over my own life. Yeah. Heavy.
No, it's good. No, it's cool. That's great. I love hearing your story, you know. Yeah. And it's interesting to be able to compete at such a high level. And I'm sure that sort of spirit and that energy, I mean, it was imbued in you in such a young age that I'm sure that helped you in certain aspects to craft the way that you wanted to craft an image, for instance, or how to, you know, craft your career as a photographer.
Very, very perfectionist and competitive. Yeah.
Yeah. But do you think that area of competition is more so with yourself or more so with other people?
Probably myself. Like, I never really care if, I wouldn't say I'm like never jealous of somebody else, right? But I would say, because there are people, like, you know, over the years you talk to various photographers, artists, they would feel like a little bit jealous of this or that person, or they'll be jealous of me, or but I feel like it was extremely rare for me to be jealous of someone else's achievement. And usually I tend to always turn it inward, and I don't know if it's due to my upbringing or due to air rifle, which is a very inward competitive sport. Like, it's you don't really know what someone else is shooting all the time, and it's really what's going on in your own head, right? Like, so I would, you know, if I'm not doing well, if I don't get the job, I'm always thinking like, well, I'm just not good enough, or like something is wrong with me. It's not like someone else doesn't deserve this, or, you know, someone else has more connections. Like, those kind of stuff just never really bother me as much. And it's almost like a checklist, right? I think I just want to be able to shoot for like clients at this level. You want to eventually be shooting for like Harper's Bazaar, Elle, Vogue, and you just want to, you know, check them off the list of having done it, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'll say it's more personal than against others for me. Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So to go back into some of the anime and your interest in video games, for instance, there's this theory. I mean, it's not my theory, but it's a theory that I heard before in terms of working with certainties and uncertainties within one's life. And so I can equate this to the life of being like a fashion photographer, for instance, you know, in your case. And being a fashion photographer, there's a lot of uncertainties. You don't know exactly who your next client may be. You don't know exactly. There's a lot of variables, right? And so,
yeah.
And then the certainty balance, I think in that scenario would be, and correct me if I'm wrong, but maybe for you, it's like you would know like what you would get out of a game or something, or you know a certain level of enjoyment that you would get out of that. So it's something that you can control in your life as opposed to the thing that you can't control. And I'm curious, first of all, if that is that an accurate assessment, and second of all, like what you think about that.
Could you shorten it to a more concise question? Sorry, I feel like I heard a comparison of uncertainty, but I wasn't sure what the question actually was.
I guess the question more so is, it's kind of, that was kind of like a dance of a question. I guess the question is that, you know, like in a career of a fashion photographer, there's a lot of uncertainties within that, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
But in terms of like some of your interests, you know, mm-hmm. such as your interest in, I know you used to play StarCraft mm-hmm. and you used to have a team and, and, you know, I think that there's a lot of variables within that, that you know, you'll show up and you'll get a certain result from it. Right. But sometimes within like having a career as like a photographer and more so on a macro perspective as a creative, like that, you don't necessarily get those certainties. Right. Mm-hmm. So I think that in order for a lot of people to be happy, there needs to be a balance between having certainties in your life and then uncertainties, like things that you, sorry, this is another long question, but I'm trying to understand what you think about that.
I think most things are very uncertain. Like, I mean, if I play a game for the first time, I don't actually know what is going to happen as I explore the map, you know, or as the story goes on. That's part of the pleasure to consume any type of media, right? You want to be taken on a journey and you would like to be surprised or touched or moved, or happy, sad, angry. I think, I mean, the same happens with photography. Pretty much, like the only time you really know what's going to happen is when you re-consume the media. You know, you read a story a second, third, or fourth time. But even then, I think because you know what is happening, you have more room to understand or pay attention to smaller details that you might have missed the first time. So I think, balancing unknown versus expected, I think it's fun to not know what's going to happen.
Yeah. I also wanted to talk to you about, you know, like research as a tool for growth. And you were talking about that, about the Motherland Chronicles and working with Tobias Kwan. And I was curious, like, do you do a lot of research now? And like, how has research helped you? Because, you know, there's, it might be an ego thing, but, you know, I've had conversations with various people like throughout the years of, you know, oh, I never look at other people's work because of these reasons or what have you, right? And so, but I think that in order to grow, you do need to like constantly like find new things to think about and get new information. So I was curious what you thought about that.
I also know new people who would say things like, I'm not following any photographers. Don't take it personally because I just don't want to be influenced by anyone else's work. I understand it. Personally, it's less so that I don't want to be influenced by other photographers, but I always find that, not always, but typically I am more inspired by things beyond photography. So I do like to go out there and just look at a lot of, you know, different types of art. And I would say I didn't used to research very heavily when I was younger, because it comes back a little bit to the, you don't know what you don't know, right? And you always felt like, oh, I have read like this much manga and novels and looked at this many artists, and I already know what type of style I like, you know. It sometimes you don't really understand your own hubris, right? You know, I would be very like kind of, pigeonhole myself into that very narrow path. But over the years, definitely, especially in working with Tobias, and he is one of those types of artists who research extremely deeply on any topic that he works on. And it's not super common. I have met a few artists who are like that, but for example, he was working on a VR game called Lone Echo. And he was designing a character that was a robot who is supposed to do maintenance on like a space satellite or space station. Mm-hmm. And the depth of his research, right? Just looking through all of like different biosuits that like from different countries that people have made for astronauts, like throughout history. Like he would research like the entirety of that. He would look at like different types of rockets, and he would look into the fabrication and materials that's involved in these things. And like it, from like, I would expect this from an actual like costume designer or industrial designer who is involved in the making of this. But typically with concept artists for video games, it's really easy when you can see a lot of art out there that's like, you know exactly which references they pulled from like the top 10 results on Pinterest or stuff like that, you know? So yeah. Like there is, and you know, time pressure is a thing, right? So not everybody has the luxury to spend a lot of time to research and create a character. But looking at Tobias do those type of things, it was kind of very inspiring for me, and just like, you know, made me realize that there is more I can look into that could be interesting. And when you do look at his end design, the thoughtfulness to it and how unique it is compared to maybe a different game that has, you know, maintenance in space with like biosuit and robots, there's a drastic difference in the final output. Yeah. And I thought that's very interesting. So especially given, you know, all the free time I have in the pandemic, I have been trying to just in my own ways broaden what I look at, even if it's just within, for example, within the realm of manga and anime, try to look at things that I used to think, oh, this is in an art style I completely don't love, you know, like I wouldn't write it off like I used to, right? And
yeah,
I would give it a shot, and I would read a few chapters or watch a few episodes, and there is more to it in terms of storytelling and the craft of storytelling that could be inspiring in its own way. Yeah. So it's kind of a path of discovery.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that's kind of where a lot of the magic is like trying to understand the subtleties and nuances of, I mean, you know, we only have a certain amount of time on this planet.
Yeah.
But being really attentive to things that interest you, mm-hmm. and trying to figure out like all those subtleties and nuances and just being able to study all those things, I think is really powerful, and you can have a lot of enjoyment in that. You know, I try to do that a lot in daily things that maybe might not interest some people, but
yeah,
I just think, I don't know. I guess it's just really about how you want to occupy and spend your time. And I think there's something interesting about the realization of your own hubris. And I think that leads to wisdom too, is trying to be more humble about certain things, or trying to be interested in things that you might have not been interested in before, you know, and not just writing it off as like, oh, that sucks, or that's shitty. Like, you know what I mean? Just, but
absolutely.
Being open, I think can be very powerful for people.
Yes. Not easy.
Yeah. This episode of Artists Decoded is brought to you by Mubi, a curated streaming service showing exceptional films from around the globe. Every day, Mubi premieres a new film, each one thoughtfully handpicked, from new directors to award winners. Beautiful, interesting, incredible movies, there is always something new to discover. I recently watched the contemporary Japanese classic, Tokyo Sonata, and you can watch it on their platform, then listen to us speak about this Kiyoshi Kurosawa masterpiece on our new AD Movie Club, which will be premiering on our podcast on Thursday, June 17th. You can try Mubi free for 30 days at mubi.com/artistsdecoded. That's Mubi, mubi.com/artistsdecoded for a whole month of great cinema for free. Okay, so back to the episode. I did want to talk to you also about your creative writing class that you took at Cambridge. Mm-hmm. And
yeah.
I mean, speaking about, you know, being open to things that you wouldn't have necessarily done in the past. And I wanted to know what you got out of that. And
I loved it a lot for no reason other than that, like, Cambridge has, like, just really beautiful campus. And it's just very, it feels very wonderful to be there. And yeah.
It's romantic.
It's romantic, yeah. And
you're a romantic, huh?
I am a romantic, yes. I don't know. It's so up until that point, you know, when I decided to take the creative writing class, it was a very short program. But up until then, I've always kind of avoided things that I kind of like, but feel that I don't really have a talent in. I think, you know, like maybe from early day competitiveness and just growing up with really overachieving friends, it felt like it would be worthless or pointless to do things if I am like 10, 20 years behind my friends, you know? And like, I want to be stand next to them and not feel like embarrassed or ashamed, or I want to feel worthwhile standing next to them. So that's something else, like psychologically to unpack. But so up until then, I did always used to focus on things I would naturally feel that I pick up very easily and I would be very talented at, which is like, for example, with air rifle and with photography and even managing artists or you know, trying to put like a StarCraft team together. Like there would be things I felt that came to me more naturally and would be easier to see progress and improvement in. And you know, I like to read, but writing is such a long process, right? And it just seemed like, and English was not my like first language. So there are many things that just feel like, oh, writing would be difficult, you know? I don't really have stories to tell. But I did reach the point where I started thinking, when I decided I wanted to quit fashion, like maybe it's not so bad to spend some time to pursue just hobby's sake and just see how far that can go or see if I learn anything new. And so the whole creative writing program was just an extension of that thought. And I enjoyed it and I learned things and I made friends. So it was very fun. Yeah. Mm. It was, and unfortunately I'm not very talented in it. I think I did okay, but yeah, it's hard.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, you know, you're essentially learning a new medium in a new language of sorts, right? Mm-hmm. So for you, you know, maybe in photography and the lighting sense and your ideas within a still image, you know, you may be very fluent in that, right? Mm-hmm. But
yeah,
if you go to writing, that might be a different story, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you can't pick it up. It just means that you haven't built the skills as much as you have with your photography, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. There was a really nice thing that a writer friend told me, which was like the gap between taste and reality is just practice, you know? And I thought that was like such a beautiful and eloquent good way to put it. Writers. Yeah. So. Right.
Yeah, of course that came from a writer. No, no, right. That's not. Yeah.
It was very beautiful. I was like, oh, that makes perfect sense. Yes. Yeah. I should use my brain sometime too.
Yeah. No, that's great. Yeah. I try to think about that too in terms of just the beginner's mindset of things. You know, being okay with starting something new and trying, even if it's a hobby, just trying to discover something about yourself from that. And I think that, you know, that could lead to something else, you know, and so you're just constantly like unlocking doors, windows of your own soul.
I think it's important. And I think it gets, it gets much harder as we get older and as we get more established in our career. Yeah, because it feels like there is so much more at stake. I mean, for example, if I'm thinking about writing, even if I know that I don't have to be a best-selling author, but I'm like, well, if I put something out under my name and it's embarrassing, like, well, that would suck because there is a certain level of branding attached to my name, right? And you do worry a lot about how things will come out. Yeah. Well, I did. Just expectations for myself. That's different from what reality could be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I think, and that's where I think, being able to be understanding and self-reflective enough to understand, well, and also, you know, having people around you, like if you were to come out with a book, to have people proofread it.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, but I don't know, like there's something interesting to me about that, the beginner's mindset and, kind of relinquishing your fear of the expectation of what other people may think. And, not that I have it figured out at all, but it's just something that I think about.
I think it's such a great advantage if you can just push ahead and take advantage of it, because like, you know, before my eye was as honed as it is now, right? There's so much imperfections in my work that I can't really tell, but I was so much better at putting out pictures in quantity back then because, well, this is the best single picture for my entire photo shoot. And now I'm just constantly paralyzed that, oh my God, I have 20 photos from this set and like 5 images are all really good, but it's from the same look and I can't put out all 5 of them. So I don't know which one to pick and I just end up not putting any. And I just constantly have this problem and it's, sometimes, I think there's a lot of benefits to being an ignorant and inexperienced beginner, for sure. Yeah.
No, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. I think there's something, and maybe this is just kind of being romantic about the whole idea, but, that childlike naivety, you know, and thinking about how you can relinquish your judgments on the things that you create. And I mean, even if it's just, you're just creating something and you're not going to put it out there, but just creating it. And for instance, do you know who Phil Hale is?
Yeah. I met him once.
Oh, okay. In Tokyo. Yeah. So, oh, cool. Yeah. So Phil, when I first met Phil, he, I'll never forget this because he was painting at one of his friend's houses in LA and he invited me over to do the art interview back, way back when. And they were painting squids.
That's funny.
And he's like, sometimes you got to paint some stupid squids. And I just thought I just thought that was really endearing and it's something that, although he probably wasn't, you know, meaning to inject any sort of like life realizations within me, I think it is just something that I found to be really endearing and something that I think about sometimes in terms of like approaching new things and with openness, you know, and instead of fear.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Sounds fun.
I don't know.
Like him. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But anyways, I did want to talk more about like animes and some of your favorite artists and like some video games and stuff.
Sure.
But I guess really like what I was curious is like what you've been, what sort of realizations that you've come from playing some of these video games. I mean, I have my own personal relationship with video games and I'm sure you do, but it seems like you and I are attracted to like different types
very
of video
different
games.
I find that
very, very
probably.
Different games.
Probably. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I, for instance, I recently played The Last of Us 2. I mean, recently as in like 6 months ago, and I mm-hmm. beat it.
Oh, that's great.
That, yeah, that game is
I never
is
played
amazing.
Because I think survival type of games is like, it's very stressful for me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, totally. They're yeah. totally stressful.
I'm like, I'm already stressed in real life. So when I play, I usually avoid things like horror or survivor or shooters. Just, yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, they're extremely stressful. Mm-hmm. Like, Resident Evil, the last couple games that they put out, The Village yeah. and Biohazard. Mm-hmm. I've only played Biohazard, but the Resident Evil 7. Mm-hmm. But I've been watching like breakdowns on The Village, and mm-hmm. Yeah, it just seems super stressful. I don't know. Maybe I like that stress. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe it's a different kind of catharsis.
Enjoyment.
Yeah, for people. For me personally, it's tough. Yeah, I just get kind of frustrated, and it's not enjoyable for me. Yeah, to add further stress.
what sort of games do you get enjoyment out of?
I like easy like. And wholesome games, so like JRPG, like it's really good for me because you know you have kind of a preset storyline and you just look at pretty characters and environment and animation and you figure out what kind of things to build and you know get new gear equipment and the slightly more relaxing stuff that I can play. The only exception was StarCraft 2, but that was I guess I just missed the competitiveness in Air Rifle. So at that time, I was into it, and when I made a team, I was just really curious to see how far we could go. Yeah, different type of stress,
and
but it was
interesting. How far
did
was
we
that?
Go? We were pretty strong as far as like being non. Like professional, we were like semi-pro, we had players in some major tournaments that basically had no other like non-professional teams in. Like we would be the only like semi-pro, or if you want to call like serious amateur team to be in like certain major tournaments. That's like really premium, yeah. So good as far as that went, but. Still mentally exhausting. Like it was a big learning experience for me because it sounds very stupid in retrospect, by the way, but to learn that people actually think differently and are motivated by different things, because I felt like I was providing good environment and opportunities for my players. For example, we would have one or two really strong players and they would not be motivated the same way that I was for Air Rifle. And it just completely baffled me. Like, why would you not want to practice more? Why would you not want to stream if I got you featured on the front page of Team Liquid? Why would you not stream after sent you $1,000 to buy a computer that's, you know, capable of streaming? It's just like many things that just make me feel like, hey, you have these things almost handed to you and you just, you know, did not take the opportunity that was given. Yeah. And sometimes people are just different.
What do you think the disconnect was there between what you wanted, what they would want? I mean, in just more of a macro perspective.
I think maybe because I grew up in quite a competitive and professional environment since I was very young. And, you know, being Chinese, like I took piano when I was a kid. And when I was born... I was born in the shooting village, like national team in China. So I grew up there with like basically Olympic medalists. That's people I call like auntie and uncles and godmothers. Wow. Yeah, so his is like getting an Olympic gold is the standard for what you should achieve in life, you know? So, wow. So I didn't realize that was not super normal until like way later too, by the way. So that's my frame of mind in life for a very long time. So for this kid, he just wanted to play StarCraft for fun, right? And he had professional players as friends, but even if he wants to be good, there might have been other things on his mind. But of course, that's not how it was to me. Because to me, if you want to do this and if someone is there to help you, you commit to it and you go to the very top, because that's what I would do. But so at that time, to me, it was just unfathomable why he did not realize how lucky he was at, you know, the things that I got for him, the opportunities that I procured, and just, yeah, shed all over it. So that was very difficult for me, because obviously the team was like my baby, but ultimately I'm not a player that's showing up in the tournament. So if he's unprofessional and he doesn't show up to a tournament, there's nothing I could freaking do, right? And then it was very painful for me. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So then you played as did you play as well?
I played casually. Casually until we made a team, and then I basically went fully into managing it. Yeah. So.
Oh, interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. No, I like that you have stepped into all sorts of various types of modes of thinking. I think that just over time, you know, creates growth and probably ways that you might not realize at the time that you're doing it, but over time, you know, you're essentially building new skills. And
yeah, for sure. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Well, I was curious, I'll ask one more question. I do ask this of every guest, but do you have any advice for artists and creatives?
For artists and creatives? I honestly don't know what is good advice for people these days. I think learning how to research a lot is very valuable, and I don't think is taught enough, both in terms of in art school or in, you know, online by big artists. Yeah, because we go back to the whole thing of like, you don't know what you don't know, you know, and research just opens up, like, it's just so many doors to different types of things, and it can be so inspiring in teaching you like what you can add to your practice. Yeah. So I think I would advise learning about how to research a lot and having the patience for it, because it doesn't always seem like it's directly related to the art itself. And it might not directly be easy to translate into the work, but I think it's very valuable. And what else? I don't know. Be hardworking.
That's solid. I think it's solid advice.
Yeah, I think there are still so many people out there. We often talk about this with other artist friends, just how much entitlement that there might be from like general audience. And I'm not talking about this as like newer artists or, you know, other people, but just audience in general. And sometimes people feel like they feel like good artists got to where they are with shortcuts, right? Or they feel like they deserve more themselves. I don't know. It's a lot of these kind of things out there. And I just feel maybe there is like not enough emphasis on hard work out there. And everybody I know who's good at what they do, who is established, has worked very, very, very hard, whether they are commercial or artistic. And I think that's not appreciated enough, because it's not interesting to write about, because it's just hard work.
Yeah. No, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of things behind the scenes that people don't realize that goes into the life of an artist, whether that's from, you know, you have your email day where you sit there and do all your emails, or, mm-hmm. you know, just making sure that your relationships with other people are, still solid, people that you work with, or, yeah. you know, so there's a lot mm-hmm. of things that go into it that, that aren't just romantic and, frou-frou-y. I don't know if that's the right word to use, but you know, it's not all like flowers and sunshine.
I swear to God, like, especially when I was in New York, when we get assistants or intern applications, so many people just hope that you have photo shoots to watch every single day. And I'm like, oh, no, actually being a photographer is 99% like pre-production and post-production. So, <Yeah. laughs> you know, if you want to see a photo shoot every day, actually being a full-time assistant is great because you go on set every single day. But being a photographer, you would not be on set every single day unless you're any label visit or something. But yeah.
Yeah. But that's like, but I think people want to glamorize like the 1% of the 1%, you know?
Yeah. But that's really not the norm. Yeah.
Yeah. For sure. But I think that's very much embedded in like Western culture, is glamorizing the 1% of the 1%. You know, it's, you know, whoever won the, I don't know, the career lottery of sorts, but that's not necessarily applicable to everyone.
Yes.
Right. There's many things that happen along the way that someone gets there, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, I don't know. I'm just here asking questions.
That's fine.
Yeah. But anyways, thanks for doing this. I appreciate you for taking this time.
Yeah, no worries. It was fun.
Yeah, taking time out of your day, and it was good just catching up with you as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, definitely. Cool. All right, well, take it easy.
Yeah, you too. Take care.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in. See you next time.